Hello, everyone. My name is Constantin Caraivan, and I'm a release engineer working with Adobe. I will be presenting how to use Jenkins for the build and partially for the deployment of the .NET applications. First of all, I would like to know a bit about yourself. How many of you are using Jenkins with the .NET projects? Can you raise your hands? Oh, okay, so there are quite a few people. And are you using them mostly for web application or for desktop? Desktop. Okay, great. So this talk will be mostly about our experience with migrating an existing .NET stack to Jenkins. We had a cruise control stack, which cruise control .NET is an integration server for .NET. It's built with the .NET technologies. And one day, our managers came to me and told me to try to expand the build infrastructure and the release infrastructure using our existing systems. And we decided that the best thing to do was to migrate to Jenkins, to switch to Jenkins. I will talk a bit about our product first to present the initial situation. So Business Catalyst is a platform for building online businesses. It's for building websites and online businesses without great technology, web technology needed. And behind the scenes, it's a collection of .NET applications. There's a lot of code. So there are, for the server side languages like C# and VB, more than 1 million lines of code. And also a lot of XML resources and client-side files. And there are tens of thousands of classes during the build of the actual project. And at the start of the migration, we had several cruise control .NET servers. One was dedicated to the build part, another one to the integration test part, and several to the organized by one single server. They were used for the test environment deployment. The main problem with this setup is what it was hard to scale. It was hard to configure, and considering all the other requirements, it was hard to expand the infrastructure quickly. So that's why we had to take a leap of faith and try to move to Jenkins to see how that would work. For the scripts themselves, we were using MS Build, like almost all .NET projects, and batch scripts. And we also had lots of scheduled tasks on the machines. So we had a problem with this because you couldn't see the whole configuration from a single vantage point. You didn't have a central dashboard. So this is a diagram of the initial system with the servers. So the red square is the build server. The blue one is the integration machine, and the green ones are the test environment deployment systems. You'll see that the connections between them are a little flaky. What we discovered with the previous system was that we each test machine had a cruise control .NET instance started and linked to a central server. When one of those test instances failed, all the system was basically blocked. It timed out. And that was a major problem when trying to scale, because we have a lot of teams working together. And if one of their systems blocks, you basically block deployment on the test environments for everyone. In our case, because we have a web application, we need to build the application, run it through integration tests, and then we need to deploy it on several test environments which are similar to production. We have multiple teams, so each team has a test environment to deploy on. So they all need to work in parallel on these test environments. And because the cruise control .NET connections were so flaky, it was hard to keep the system up and running. So everything was like a rundown house. It was hard to keep everything running smoothly. It was hard to not have an impact on different teams. And we persuaded our management team to move to Jenkins. It's not a very common mix. I also saw that not a lot of you raise your hands, because Jenkins is a Java server considered. mostly for Java continuous integration, but we thought it would be a good fit for .NET too. At my previous employer, I worked with Jenkins for a lot of technologies, including Java, C++, C, custom systems, and I was confident enough that we could use it for .NET too. This is an overview of the architecture we decided to use for the Jenkins system. So we wanted to use a master-slave system. We wanted to have everything connected to different machines. We decided on having one single master with a single dashboard so we could have everything gathered on the same place to make it easy for management to have the good view of the system. We kept most of our scripts, and we also created some Python scripts. And now we have lots of Jenkins jobs instead of all sorts of scheduled tasks, Windows tasks on machines. The scheduled tasks are like cron jobs in Unix. So this is how it looks right now. So there's the red Jenkins master. On the same machine, we have a Jenkins build slave. The master itself is a quite capable machine. And we now have slaves for each role. So for example, the integration machines have now just become Jenkins slaves. They're not independent servers. They're linked to the main Jenkins instance. This is also good as compared to cruise control because there was not really that much integration between the independent cruise control.NET servers. With Jenkins, it's easy to pass information around and get like info like the build number to the integration machine. The test environment slaves are also Jenkins slaves. And we've also managed to add automated test runners for the test environment. So we have the initial build, then we go to the integration tests, then we deploy the code on the test environments, and after that we run automated tests, for example, JMeter or Selenium. So those machines run also Jenkins jobs, which connect to the test environments and run through the web application itself. Fill forms, run tests. And now it's much nicer and it's much easier to scale because you can add Jenkins slaves a lot easier than you did with the cruise control. The migration plan sounds very easy, so just initially keep the cruise control.NET server, have a proof of concept Jenkins server to see that everything works okay, run both systems in parallel for a while, and then when you're confident that the new system works, just switch it over and after a while turn off the other server. We moved each component gradually, so initially we just used Jenkins for the build part. That proved okay. Then we moved the integration part too, and then the test environment deployment. And it was quite a success. During the migration, some things we noticed for the actual migration was that .NET integration is easier than expected. The Jenkins community has written a lot of good plugins, which we use. So there are plugins to integrate MS Build for the build and unit for the running of the unit tests and also graphing the results of the unit tests. We also integrated Ncover. For this, we actually have some small custom scripts, but it was quite easy. And of course, you have PowerShell runners. For example, if you want to run PowerShell, Windows PowerShell scripts, there's a Jenkins plugin which can do that. The system is easily accessible now because Jenkins is easy to use. So you just log in into the web interface. One of the problems with the old system was that it had its own user database. Now we have an Active Directory login, so you can just connect to your corporate domain, and everybody can log in with the same user and password. The system is a lot more flexible now because we're using masters and slaves. We just add slaves as we need them. So we need a new build machine, just create that machine, add it as a slave, and everything's connected. And we also use metric jobs for deployment. I don't know if you probably know about multiple configuration jobs or metric jobs. Can you raise your hands if you don't know? Okay, so when you want to configure a Jenkins job, there's an option of creating a simple job, which runs a certain command or build. And there's an option of creating a multiple configuration build. In that case, you can set a, create a sort of axis with multiple parameters. And then when the job launches, it launches all those configurations in parallel. For example, if you want to run on multiple machines, or if you want, for example, for Java, if you want to use different Java versions, you just specify, I need to run this using Java 1.4, 1.5, 1.6. And you create the job. And when you launch it, it will launch all three configurations in parallel. And this is very good because you don't have duplication. You just have one central configuration, which launches whatever you need in parallel. There's also the security part. Ryan's presentation was more about a developer's point of view. I come from a DevOps point of view. And one of our concerns is having security enforced. And there's a plugin which is called the role-based authorization strategy. It's quite a long name. Basically, you can create groups of users. So you create groups of users with different roles, and then you assign users to these roles. And for example, when someone from our Active Directory domain logs into the server, he has just basic rights. He can't do a lot. For that, he needs to be assigned to a higher level group, like an admin or a member of a certain project. And with that plugin, you can configure the roles. And of course, the visibility. Jenkins itself has a very good web dashboard. I think you've probably seen it, so I won't go into that. But there's also a nice plugin called the Wall Display plugin. So what it does, it creates an image like that. So if you have a nice wall display, you select a list of jobs that everybody will see. So when you're working in your office, you can just look up at the monitor and you'll see the list of jobs that are running, which one are working, which one failed, and who broke the last build, which is one of the most important parts. Here, there's no build broken, but when it's broken, there's a name of the culprit included. Unfortunately, not everything is rosy. There are still some problems. There can be compatibility problems because Jenkins is using a lot of plugins and not all of them are kept up to date. Some of them might have conflicts with the latest Jenkins versions. And another problem we noticed that when you upgrade, if you use a lot of plugins like 40 or 60, there's a good chance that one of them will break. So of course you'll have to use a test instance of Jenkins before moving on to the production environment. Sometimes the main instance can get stuck, so that might require a restart. But it happens maybe once per week, so it's not a problem unless you're trying to use it for production deployment, which we're not using yet. So it's okay. There are some parts which I'd call ugly. You can make them work, but it will be a bit more tricky than you'd want to, and you have to be careful. The first part is connecting the actual Windows slaves. On Unix, it's super easy because you just SSH to the machine and everything works. On Windows, especially for the newer version since Windows Vista, there's the UAC and all the other security stuff. And the service, the Jenkins will try to create a service on that remote machine, and sometimes that might fail, and you'll get a cryptic decom message with the error, which is not very clear. And for that, I have a link at the end of the presentation. There are some wiki pages, very very good wiki pages on the Jenkins wiki, where you can see the actual pages and the comments of people debating how to solve those various problems. In our case, there are three options for connecting Windows machines. So you can use Cygwin, which is a sort of Unix emulation on Windows. But that's not good for all the situations. There are some tools which don't work correctly through Cygwin. You can use JNLP, which is Java Web Start. So you go on the slave machine, start the a web browser pointed to Jenkins, loading a page, and then you can tell it to connect to the server. But in this case, if you want to move the server, for example, you won't have all the information centrally available. So you move, if you move the master instance, you'll have to reconnect all those slaves. And the first solution, the third solution, which you're using right now, is to have Jenkins use WMI to connect to Windows, to connect remotely to Windows, and create a local service. In this case, you'll have to set some security configurations on the machine. But after that, everything works all right. And if you need to move the Jenkins server itself, everything just works, because you'll have the list of machines you're connecting to. You already have the users and passwords and everything needed to connect. So it's easy to move servers around to migrate. Another, let's call it ugly part, is the memory usage. In our case, we're hovering around 2 gigabytes of RAM with 40 slaves connected, but it can go all up a lot higher depending on the actual activity. And if you want to use it in a cloud environment, it might get tricky. For a local machine, if you have a local machine, it's probably not a problem. You just add another stick of RAM and you're all set. I made a sort of comparison table for this migration. We had a list of points we had to cover. These were the base points, so the main ones. Of course, we needed to connect to the source control, which in our case is Perforce. So this was not a problem with either system. We needed to be able to run the build tool. Again, not a problem. We wanted to be able to run unit tests and see the test results. And I think Jenkins fares better in this respect, because it has those nice graphs where you can see the evolution, the trend, how many tests you ran in the past, how many of them failed, how many of them succeeded. The CCNet, the cruisecontrol.net dashboard, was much weaker from this point of view. There's also WANcover, so we can see the coverage of the unit test to see how the project is evolving. And there are also the communication parts of the continuous integration server, like having an email sent out when a build is successful or fails. This is okay with both systems. And there's also a tray application. Some people don't like to keep their email client open at all times because they might be spammed. So they close the client and just want a small tray application to see the status. There's a Jenkins tray application, but it's not as nice as the cruisecontrol.net. Fortunately, there is backwards compatibility. Jenkins publishes a cruisecontrol.net XML file, which can be read by the cruisecontrol.net application. So you have people using the old cruisecontrol.net application, but they're actually connecting to Jenkins and seeing the nice status in their tray. So that's also nice. We also moved to Jenkins for deployment, for now just on the test environment. We use those matrix jobs I mentioned, and this is a view of a matrix job. So here you can see the different tasks executed and the machines they're run on. So we have several web machines, a database machine, and then we update the code and the database. The not so good part is that there's some configuration still duplicated, because for each test environment, we have one of these jobs. So if we need to update something for each test environment, we need to configure them individually. We can't have one sort of master job. They still have to be split across the environments. And it's also not as easy to scale. You can scale it, but the main problem is you create a matrix, like you see over there. And then, if you want to execute commands, you have to filter them out, the grayed out balls. And there's an expression below, I'm not sure it's very readable. Basically, it's a sort of if. Run this on a certain machine, run this operation on this certain machine. In our case, we want to run the database update on the database machine, the code update on a different machine, on different machines. So we don't want to run the code update on the database machine, because that wouldn't make sense. So there's a filter over there which says, if you're on the database machine, run this operation. Unfortunately, when we go to production, this kind of filtering falls apart. It works for filtering, but the configuration itself is very hard to do, because we'll have a lot of machines with different roles. So we can't have just one long text box with a huge filter system, which is very complex and hard to debug. It's like those huge, almost like those huge regexpies that expressions that nobody knows exactly how to debug. It takes hours and hours to debug. We're also investigating some Jenkins plugins to try to move to using Jenkins for production deployment on the production environment. And the main goal is to have the same execution scenario for all environments. So we run the same commands in the same exact order on all the environments with no differences outside of parameters like host names and small stuff like that. And for this, there are two plugins which can be used. One of them is the node label parameter. Basically, when you create a matrix job, you can create a matrix job to be launched on a label. So you have a group of machines with the same label. But Jenkins currently, because it's mainly a continuous integration server, build server, will launch the build on just one of those machines. So it's a capability. You say, I have 10 machines which have N cover, and then it won't launch in parallel the build in parallel on all 10 machines. It will just select one. But in our case, in production, we want to have a sort of label, but launch the command on all those machines. We want to run the code update on all the web machines, for example. And this is not possible with the default Jenkins setup, but this plugin, the node label parameter plugins, allows us to do this. We just say, OK, I'm using this label. And in this case, don't select one node, just launch it on all the nodes. So that makes it possible to do large-scale deployments, where you just add machines, you tag them, you label them with a certain label, and then you just launch the execution by configuring this plugin. The second part is the parameterized trigger plugin. Basically, we want to make a main execution scenario with all the steps we want to run, and then we'll have another, let's call it shell job, which triggers the other ones, but it provides it the parameter. So it says, right now you're running on staging on this data center with this configuration, but the actual execution is exactly the same on all the environments. If you're interested in stuff like this, you can come to me after the presentation. I'll show you our mini prototype about this this part. And after all this migration work, and even after the migration, we've managed to learn some lessons, which I'll be sharing. So first of all, for a new .NET project, I think it's a very good idea to use Jenkins. The previous contender, CruiseControl.net, is not very well maintained. The community behind it is moving very slowly. And the tools supporting .NET from Jenkins are good. So if you're ever in need for developing a .NET project, maybe you've changed the job or you need to start a new project which requires .NET, you can use Jenkins safely. It definitely works. If you want to use a specific plugin, as Ryan, for example, before me said, it's a good idea to test it in several configurations, especially in master-slave setups and with matrix jobs, because not all plugins support that. It's one of the first failure scenarios. So you just download the plugin, install it in a test instance, start it, and you notice that it doesn't work correctly when using a matrix job, or it doesn't work correctly on a slave. It assumes that it's on a master and it works locally. Another thing we discovered is that it's not a good idea to execute anything on the master if you have a larger setup, because if you execute something on the master, it basically could crash the Jenkins master, and then you'll be blocking everybody. If you just use a slave which connects to the same machine, so a slave connected locally, something goes wrong, you just disconnect that slave, restart it, whatever, and then everything is okay. If you run a lot of things on the master, you're already loading the server. The master, from the beginning, has a lot of work. It's used for controlling the slaves, for reporting, for managing the general system, so it's not like it's standing still. It's a good idea to version your configuration files. There are lots of options, like storing them in Git, creating all sorts of jobs which commit to Git or copying them somewhere else. In our case, we found a job config history plugin, which is exactly what we need. It provides the diff between different versions, and because we have logged in users, you can see who modified and what exactly they modified. There's a small diff, so you can just see it. Another sore point in the past was that the builds were not separated from the configuration files. So you had the Jenkins instance, and inside the Jenkins folder, there was a build folder. And in there, you had the configuration files for all your builds and also the binaries, a lot of binaries. So you had to copy, painstakingly copy, just what you needed. Right now, there's an option in the configuration of Jenkins. When you install it, you click Manage Jenkins, and there's an option to use different folders, to say you store the build in this folder and the configuration in a different folder. So you just back up the configuration files, which are small, and you're set to go. And of course, don't allow anonymous configuration access. Even if it's a small instance, if you have a corporate directory, connect to that, let them connect you using the regular users. And this way, you won't have any kind of discussions about who modified what or what happened. And you don't, especially in the logs, you won't see a system has edited this file. You'll see who actually edited the file. One of the things that hurt us a lot, even if you manage to have a good Jenkins setup, so you have everything up and running okay, if your build scripts are bad, everything will still be hard to manage. Try to separate the solutions, because otherwise, Jenkins, for example, has possibilities for build pipelining, where you just build a certain part of the project, and then you trigger another build, and you just build everything quickly. If you have a big monolithic solution, it's hard to do that. And another thing would be to try to rotate developers on build duty. If you're on a big project, you might have build engineers or release engineers, but it's a good idea to try to get the regular developers involved in that those tasks, at least for 1 or 2 days, for them to get to know the build system. It's amazing how many people don't know how their project is being built and what happens during the build. It's a sort of black magic, and you wouldn't expect that from someone working on a project for several years. Now for the questions and answers part. If you have any questions. These are some links about connecting Windows slaves to a Jenkins instance. Okay. What kind of .NET integration? Things are mostly okay. I think for the code coverage, there are two tools, ncover and .cover. Those would be nice if they could be integrated in the regular Jenkins reporting. For the actual .NET parts, specific parts, I don't think there are many points. other pain points we've been having were the deployment related parts, trying to use Jenkins for deployment when you have several data centers and a lot of servers. And for example, I spoke about the no label parameter plugin. This is very nice, but a native option to just be able to launch a build on all the machines on a specific label would be awesome. There is maybe in the latest version. We haven't upgraded for a while because we need to go through all the testing when upgrading the instance.
When we have these long-running jobs, it just makes, if the server goes down, all these jobs have to be restarted. We try to break these down, but that's a tough process. To accumulate the results at the end and combine it all together.
The question was, what if you have long-running regression tests that cause the machine to fail, the slave fail?
Well, that where the server could go down, okay. And all the long-running tests are then have to be restarted.
Yeah, I don't think there's currently a way to resume running tests. I think that's also a part. How are you running the regression tests? What tool are you using? Because that's also, at least from my point of view, it's up to the test runner itself to have maybe a resume possibility. That would be nice. Okay.
Once the artifacts are built, do you use Maven repositories at all, or have you tried that?
Unfortunately, we're not using Maven repositories. For .NET, there have been several attempts to replicate the whole Maven ecosystem. But the tools themselves have been built, but it's not about the code. It's about creating the repository, storing everything, having conventions, getting everyone to use the same conventions. So no, unfortunately, we're not using repositories. We have some Java parts, and we're slowly moving to Java. So we might try to mix them to see if we can get to use the same Maven repositories. But there's nothing already built. We'd have to create custom code for everything ourselves. Okay. Our artifact right now is a collection of DLL files. It's a huge zip archive, which is copied to the production machines. We use it to deploy on the test environments, and right now we're trying to move to the staging environment and to the production environment. We use rsync. And I've also been testing Git, using Git for the actual binaries. I know it sounds strange, but I did some benchmarks, and the performance is quite good. And it was even faster than rsync. So in our case, with the large binaries, I think we might use that. I know it can be tricky, but the initial tests look promising. For that, we have custom scripts developed in-house. There's a quite complex sequence of deployment. So we stop services, we have load balancers, caches. The application itself is a set of services. It's not just one IIS part. And so it's all custom code. And right now, for the production deployment, we're using ControlTier, which is okay, but it's been end of life by its developers, so we're trying to move to Jenkins. Jenkins is not used a lot for deployment, for web deployment. Mostly Chef or Puppet are used, but in this case, especially considering that we have Windows machines, it's probably the best option, considering that we have custom scripts. Okay. Any Okay, so I think you are first, sorry. Okay.
So this may be a dumb question, but no problem.
So I should repeat the question. What happens if you try to load snap-ins for PowerShell, since Jenkins tries to use the 32-bit instance of PowerShell? Well, unfortunately, we haven't been loading snap-ins, so we haven't run into that problem.
Have you found a way to actually get, does anyone know of a way to actually get Jenkins to run in this 64-bit instance in Windows environment?
Well, I did a sort of hack. I think the regular Java runtime environment used by Jenkins is 32-bit, but you can replace the folder with the 64-bit. Kosuke might not approve of that, but that's what we did. Yeah, I think it's most likely 32-bit. From what I remember, I had to change it because we were running into memory issues, out of memory issues. So there, that would be a good idea to have a specific setup for 64-bit. Okay, so there was...
Yeah, my question is not it's not .NET necessarily, it's more C++.
Okay.
So we have an application, and we have to build it depending on the environment with different versions of the C++ compiler.
Okay. First of all, how do you call CMake? Because I don't know, is there a plugin which calls CMake?
Well, I couldn't figure that out, so that part we just did it
for. Okay. I think you could try to use the metric style job configuration where you have different labels for each CMake versions, and then. Maybe a small custom script to detect the version you're running on and then launching the appropriate CMake. I mean, it should be just several small lines of code. That's probably the safest bet for CMake, because I don't think the C++ integration is... the .NET integration is probably better than the C++ integration. Okay, so... You specify that in your projects, in your solutions. You can specify the target and the version 64-bit, 32-bit. So maybe you can't do that with CMake because you need to select the executable. Yeah, and then it's a bit trickier. Okay. So I think there was another question. Ah, okay.
How to spawn multiple tests after the deployment stage?
How do you run multiple tests after deployment stage?
Can I spawn it like, you know, since
the deployment on the test environment is a Jenkins job, at the end of it, you could have it triggering something else. You just... So the answer is to use the Matrix plugin?
Yeah.
Okay. And to get it recorded. You want to capture blue screens of depths in case of tests, probably?
Yeah, well, probably external execution.
Okay. I'm not sure about blue screens of death because through the IIS applications, you can't really cause that. Are you writing drivers?
Yeah.
Okay, then. Sorry, I'm not sure I know a solution for that.
Do you have any other sort of solutions in terms of maybe the IIS level, as tests are running, those field logging and execution across all your test nodes?
So you want to gather logs from the different parallel execution of tests. Maybe you could archive them from all your executions and copy them to a central location on the master, for example. That could be a solution. There would be probably different files, but at least they'll be in the just one location. So should be enough. Okay. So if there are no more questions, thank you for coming, for attending, and for your questions. And we'll probably head out to lunch because I think, okay. Thank you.